Hello everyone and welcome to this series Machine Learning with Oracle. Today we're looking at applying machine learning to forecasting. My name is Jeroen Kloosterman, I'm a Business Development Manager for Business Analytics at Oracle. And I'm going to show you hands-on how to implement a forecasting case. We're going to look at an example case that's focused on forecasting sales or demand. Machine learning is pretty good at forecasting. It often outperforms the more traditional statistical methods. I've split this session into three parts. And in the first part, we're starting with the business case that we use as an example. We'll also cover the required machine learning theory, so you don't need to have any prior knowledge on the subject. Now, later on in this part, we're actually going to load the required input data into our environment of choice, the Oracle Autonomous Data Warehouse Cloud. And of course, I'll explain why that is a good match for our case. The second part covers how to actually create a prediction model. And here we are really going to work hands-on with the notebook of ADWC, the real data science part. And in part 3, you learn how to automate and embed the prediction into an application. And you learn how to get started yourself with ADWC, for example, how to get access to your own environment. I also recommend you to have a look at the text below the video. There's an index that you can use to fast forward to all the other parts of the video. And if you've got any questions or comments, there's also a link there to a small questionnaire for you to share your feedback, and you can also use the questionnaire to get in contact with me directly. So we've taken a fictitious company that sells yogurt drinks. They purchase basic yogurt and fresh ingredients such as berries, strawberries. They mix it up and then they sell it to their end consumers. And what we're going to do for this company is to give them a prediction of the demand they can expect the next day, with the goal, of course, that they can order the right amount with their suppliers. So here we see the application that's currently being used by the purchaser of a company. There's no machine learning yet at this point. So here you see where he needs to enter the amount for the next day's delivery. To keep things very simple and for you to learn about machine learning without too much complexity, let's say they only plan one day ahead. So their method is that they order the night before and then it's delivered the next morning. So in fact, here you see how that order is being placed. How does the purchaser now know how much raw product to order? Well, he doesn't really. He only has this chart here at the top of the screen that helps him a little bit to give him an idea of where the sales might be headed the next day. But it's a human task and it's very easy to make errors. And that's what's happening to this company. The two issues they really run into is that sometimes they order too much. When they order too much, they have to throw their fresh product or their fresh raw ingredient away at the end of the day. And sometimes to compensate, they order not enough. And then at the end of the day, they end up with empty shelves, disappointing customers. So we're going to try to help this purchaser by giving him a more accurate estimate with an automated prediction. The next question, of course, is how do we deliver this estimate to him? We could, of course, create some kind of business intelligence report, give that to him in a printed or in a PDF version, and then it's up to him to take action. But what would be even better is to take that number, this estimation, and integrate it into this application. Because then it really becomes part of the day-to-day business, and it really adds value in the daily operation of this purchaser. So that's exactly what we're going to do. We're first going to build this prediction process, and then we're going to automate it and embed it in this application. So let's talk about the data sources for our example case. Sources can be either internal from my company or they can be external from outside of my company. And first of all, there's the most obvious and internal data source, the historical values of the sales time series. These values basically correspond one-on-one with the required raw product for those days. Now, in addition, we're adding an external source for weather with variables such as temperature, rain, and wind speed, because I believe that has some kind of relationship with the sales. And by the way, this source holds the historical weather values, and it also holds a few days of weather prediction from an official weather institute. Now, last of all, we have an external source with calendar data, and I believe we need that because it's important to know whether it's a working day or a weekend day or a holiday to predict the sales. So first of all, the naive model. Here we see a graphical representation of a time series. This is the sales of the last 2 years of our example company. And what we want to do is predict the next day of sales. So in this case, it will be the first day after these 2 years. Now, the simplest model to predict tomorrow's value would be the so-called naive model. And naive means in this case that you simply take the value of today's sales as the indicator of what you're going to sell tomorrow. So tomorrow's sales is the same as today's sales. It's very common practice to compare any model's performance against the performance of the naive model. So in fact, that's what we're going to do later on in the demo. So how does machine learning solve this problem? How is it going to predict the future value of the sales time series? Now, basically by approaching it as a so-called supervised learning problem. That sounds complex, but all that it really means is we're going to learn from examples. So here we see the general workflow for supervised learning. Now have a look at step one, the training phase. Because of course we know what the actual values of sales was in the past. And we also know the values of the variables of which you believe they have some kind of influence on the sales in the past. So for example, the temperature, the wind speed, whether it was a holiday, etc. Now we combine those data points for each single point in time, for each day, and we feed those combinations into the training algorithm. Now then we leave it up to the algorithm to find out what the relationships are between those input variables and the target. So for example, maybe there's a negative relationship between the working day flag and the sales. Or maybe there's a positive relationship between the temperature and the revenue. We don't know, but the algorithm will find out, even if the relationships are very subtle. So even if the relationships could not really be found by a human being. Now, the model is the thing that captures the results. So all those relationships, all those weights. And in human terms, you could say, the model is the machine's understanding of how the input variables influence the target. And then the prediction phase. So we take the new data. We need the values of the variables of which we believe they have some influence. And we need those values for the day of tomorrow. So of course we know whether tomorrow is a holiday or a working day. We can also get a fairly accurate weather prediction, which is an input variable also in this case. So together, all of those input variables go into the prediction phase. They're processed through the model and out of it comes a predicted sales volume. Now, we choose to predict only the sales of the day of tomorrow, but in principle, we could also ask the prediction algorithm for any number of days after tomorrow as well. So we call this type of supervised machine learning algorithm regression. I already covered this in my previous video. But basically, regression algorithm will always try to predict a continuous value. Now we need a place to realize our challenge, a place to consolidate all of our data and to run our machine learning algorithms on them. So we're going to use Autonomous Data Warehouse Cloud to do this. It's a special type of Oracle database. It's specialized in analytical workloads. It runs fully in the cloud. It's managed by Oracle. And very importantly, of course, it has the ability to run machine learning directly on that data in the data warehouse. So why do I do it this way instead of, for example, using typical data scientist tools such as R or Python on a local machine? Well, first of all, and most importantly, because it's all about the data. 80% of machine learning is really about collecting, cleaning, transforming data. In Autonomous Data Warehouse Cloud, you can do all your required data operations using SQL, and the standard for data querying. Now, apart from that, it's very, very easy to spin up an environment. I don't have to go through the installation of a physical machine, for example, because it's cloud. What I really noticed is the aspect of tuning that's taken away from my responsibility. So you don't have to create indexes, for example. Performance and tuning, that's all automatically done. Concluding, it means that I can focus on my business problem, on the prediction, without losing time to other activities. You can load data into the Autonomous Data Warehouse Cloud with database tools or data integration tools from either Oracle or a third party. And you can connect directly to ADWC from your data integration tool, although you have to use a special authentication configuration called a wallet on the client side. Now what you can also do is first upload files to the Oracle Cloud Object Store and then load the data from there. The benefit of that approach is that the actual data load from Object Store into WC becomes very fast that way. Now in my case, I've chosen to use DataSync to upload my data. And DataSync is an Oracle data integration tool. It makes straightforward copies of database tables and files. And I believe its simplicity or its straightforwardness, that's also its strength. Now you can use it for free if you have a subscription for ADWC. Here we see DataSync, and there are a few very straightforward steps that you need to take. So for example, here I've got my source objects, my historical sales for my table in my transactional database, and also two files, one for the weather information, historical and prediction, and for the calendar, which is called dem day. Now what you also have to do is set up the connections to your source and your target. That's done here. So for example, here I've got the operational database. Here I've got the connection to the autonomous data warehouse. Now, and there's not so much else that you have to do. Apart from that, it's defining a job. And the job basically says, how often, with what interval do you want to copy that data? So in our case, we're going to set it up to run daily, so we always have the latest information ready for our model training and for our predictions. Now here's a link that you can use to investigate the various other data integration options, and also you'll find some information here on setting up the connection using a WAD. So we have all the raw data in ADWC, and the data scientist can go to work. So let me just open my notebook. Now this notebook is basically my user interface on top of ADWC. It allows me to mix any data querying, data operations, and machine learning operations. And at the same time, it allows me to document that as well. And that's very good to experiment with data and machine learning whilst you also track why you're taking certain steps. We see the concept of notebooks also in other machine learning environments, so also other vendors than Oracle. And typically these other notebooks, they work with statistical languages of R or Python. But in our case, we work here with SQL and with PLSQL as the main languages. And as I mentioned before, that has some great benefits because these are very strong languages for working with data. And it's just such a large part of the data scientist's job to do data preparation. We've got these three data sources that we uploaded earlier. Here we see dem sale, dem weather, and dem day. Now let's join them all up so we can use them together in our training and prediction process. We're trying to make a prediction per day, so our first thought might be to summarize all of these sales grouped by day. However, we've got weather information here on the hourly level, so we could probably get better results if we could make a prediction for each hour of the day of tomorrow, and then summarize the end result to come to a total prediction for the full day. So the result here looks like this. So we basically create a new table, one entry for each hour of the last 2 years. And again, so we've simply done this with SQL so far, no need to learn anything new for most developers. But we're not yet done with our data preparation. So have a look here at this table. And you see here in red, a value that we're trying to predict, for example. So imagine we don't know the value of the 2nd of January of 2012 yet, and we're trying to predict it. Then in blue, we see all the values of the input variables that our prediction engine can use to predict the value. It's important to understand that at the moment of the prediction of each volume value, the only information that the model can use are the values within one row. So something here is still missing, because we said we also wanted to use the historical value of revenue as an input variable. And although the historical values here are in the same data set, they are not yet available on this row, on this record. So I will choose to take one historical value, and that's the total sales volume of the previous day. So in this case, it would be the 1st of January of 2012. And other candidates would be to include all values of up to 1 week back. Or we could include some calculated metrics such as the moving average, or we could even have the sales of the same day 1 week back. It's difficult to say beforehand which of these historical values will deliver the highest predictive added value, and therefore we're simply going to experiment. So let me just execute this. Now this is basically creating here a new column placeholder, and then we are going to update that value here with the value of yesterday's sales. So let's have a look at the end result. And yes, now our data looks complete. And we don't just have the information here of the weather and the calendar. We now also have yesterday's sales value to train our model with. But maybe it's not yet in the ideal format to get the maximum prediction performance. And as an example of that, I'm going to have a special look here at the date attribute. This also contains the time of the day of each transaction. So each transaction that a customer bought our product. And my suspicion is that the moment of the day is important. And so my suspicion is that there are more sales at certain times of the day than at other times of the day. So let's see if that's true. And so here I'm creating a chart. And with this query, I'm basically showing that indeed the hour of the day is of importance, because otherwise we would have seen here a fairly flat line. So this is not really a surprising result. I think it's also a nice example for you to see how we can use charts in a notebook to perform data investigations. Now, anyway, the conclusion of this is that it's a good idea to bring a separate attribute with just the hour, to create that and to bring it out so that the training mechanism can focus on hour as a separate feature, as a separate input variable. And that's why we call this type of data preparation feature generation. So let me just run this SQL to create the additional hour column as a new input variable. So I create the placeholder and I update it with the values. And here's the end result. Now we're ready to build the model, but we have to ask ourselves, how will we know if the model we build is good enough? And the answer is, we will have to validate it. And we can do that by using some historical sales volume and verifying if a prediction on those same moments in time would result in a similar value as the actual known historical sales volume. So for example, we know what the actual sales volume was on the 1st of July of 2012. And we can make a prediction for that same date using all of our input variables and then compare the two values. So we have to reserve part of our set to be used for validation. And in this case, I'll do this for 10% of the set. And based on the 10%, we will calculate a performance score, but I'll tell you more about that later on. And in my case, I choose to have each 10th day to be part of the test set. All the other days become part of the training set. By the way, for people that saw my previous videos on advanced analytics in the Oracle database, that machine learning engine is basically the same as what we see in ADWC. Only there we also have a graphical user interface for model training and prediction. So here in ADWC we don't have that, or at least not yet. And another difference here is also that with the advanced analytics option, the training and the validation set would be automatically created by this graphical user interface. And here in ADWC we are responsible for doing that ourselves. But that's okay, because it also gives us more control over the full process. And the SQL to create separate sets is not complicated. So here we create the train set. Here we create the test set, and we simply use the modulus function to split the set. So again, this part of the data science process is again a data operation, and it's also handled simply and effectively with SQL. Now we're ready for building the model. Now we're really getting into the parts of the database that are really specific for machine learning. And at the center is a command to create a model. And creating and training the model here is really the same thing. So we do this by calling a specific PLSQL package. And when we call it, we have to specify the name of the table to train on. In this case, it's a demtrain, which we just created. We also have to specify various parameters for the machine learning algorithm. And we do that by giving it a table where each record in that table is a hyperparameter. We have to create that table ourselves, and then we give that table during the calling of the PLSQL command. When we finally run the PLSQL command, out of it comes a model, and this is something that will exist in the database. It's not a table, it's an entity in itself. And in this case, we're going to give it the name of DEMREGR for regression. So first, let's create the hyperparameters table. So here I'm creating the table. You see it's something that we make ourselves. And I'm inserting the parameters. Now, I will just pick out one of these parameters that's really important, and that's the name of the exact algorithms that we're going to use. There are two different regression algorithms part of ADWC machine learning. And in our case, we're using the support vector machine regression algorithm. So I will skip the other parameters for now. Going to make the PLSQL call. So let me just create that here. So you see that we've selected the name of the model we'll get internally. We see that this is a regression algorithm. We see the input data set that we created earlier, so demtrain. And some of the other parameters are, of course, our target column. So this is our sales volume. This is what we want to predict. This automatically means that all of the other parameters, all of the other columns in the demtrain data set will be used as input variables. And we also see the name of the hyperparameters table that we just created. So let's start it. Now this can take some time because building a model can take quite a bit of performance from the environment. And that's why I actually just scaled up my ADWC environment to use more computing resources. And it's really good to have this flexibility and to use it for this peak requirement of the training phase. And then to simply scale down again when there's less need for extreme performance to save cost. Now this of course would have been impossible if we did this on our own physical hardware. So now our build has completed. And now we have our model and we want to validate how good it actually is. So for that, we're going to predict the value of every 10th day and compare that against the actually recorded historical volume of that same day. So we're going to take our test table, demtest, and we're going to add a new column to it. And that column is going to hold our new prediction. So keep in mind that we already have the actual recorded sales volume in there as well. And so that's the reason why we can compare. So let me just do the SQL to create this new column, this placeholder. And here's the SQL to run the prediction. And this is all it takes to make a prediction, this special keyword prediction. We also specify the name of the model to use, the one we just created earlier. So now you see this very simple syntax. You can also imagine how easy it would be to take an existing application that already runs on a database and to adapt it with some simple SQL to add predictive power to it. So that's it. Now we've effectively created a prediction on our test set. And now let's see how well we are doing with the prediction in our test set. So let me just create a bit of SQL that allows me to see how well the prediction is doing compared to the historical recorded values. So I've taken the first 10th day, and we see here in dark blue the actual volume of the day. We see in light blue the predicted value, and we see that it actually follows the peak quite nicely. And there's two peaks during the day, even though the prediction is maybe slightly less during those peaks. Let's take another day. So let's take the second 10th day, so day 20. And there we basically see the same pattern. So we can continue. Let's take day 50 as well. Now this has a different pattern. And in fact, this is a weekend day, I believe, with a different kind of pattern during the day. And again, our prediction is really adapting very nicely. So visually, it seems that our predictions, our models are doing quite well. But how good do we do numerically speaking? And for that, we have to look at a performance metric. And here we're going to use the so-called RMSE, the root mean square deviation. And it's really an error measurement, the error being the difference between the actual and the predicted value. So we're trying to obtain an RMSE that's as low as possible. So first of all, let's do a bit of data preparation so we can actually run our error calculation. So we have to produce the predicted and the actual values per day. So remember, we wanted to make the prediction per day, not per hour. So we're just going to summarize. So let me just create these totals. And remember that we were talking about a naive prediction. This will allow us to compare how good our machine learning model really is. So let's also include the value of our naive prediction And remember, the naive model simply takes the value of today as the prediction for tomorrow. So let's add that as well. So now we have for each 10th day, the actual volume monitored, the predicted volume according to our model, and the predicted volume according to the naive model, simply being the value of the actual volume of the day before. So now let's actually apply the formula of RMSE for both models. So let me just create the SQL. So I've run it, and you see that we're actually doing better than the naive model. We have a lower score. So that's very good. Now, in principle, we could try to improve this model, and we could try to improve its performance. And for that, we could loop back into a process. So for example, we could add other data sources, or we could look closer at feature generation of our existing data sources. But for our case, I'm happy, so we can continue to the next step. Now I'm ready to embed this into my application, but wait, I'm still missing a few things. I have not actually made any predictions on new data yet, not yet on the day of tomorrow. So let's make this prediction in a separate notebook. I've already prepared this notebook here, so let's just run through it. The first thing we do is get our input data ready, just as we did before for the training, but now for the prediction, it has to be in the same format. And also this time we only do it for one record, for the 1st of January of 2013. Now of course this really should be the day of tomorrow, but I cannot use the system date because, well, this is not real data and the data set just ends there. So we're going to make our prediction then on an hourly basis, and that's the next line here. And we put the result of those 24 predictions into a temporary table. And then in our final table, then prediction, we create our summary of the daily prediction. So next we have to take this notebook and run it automatically on a daily basis. We're going to use a job to do that. So let's just go here to the job editor. And here you see it runs automatically. Now we're ready to pick up our prediction in our application. So have a look here at the architecture to understand how we will do that. So our prediction is ready inside of a table in ADWC, and the main source of data for our application is an operational database. So to pick up the prediction from the ADWC instance, we created a database link. This means that our DEM prediction table is accessible in the operational database, and therefore also it's accessible for any applications that run on it. So let me just open the purchasing application, and indeed here we see the field that's currently still empty. So that's the field that we're now going to default with our prediction. So now in this case the application is built using Oracle Apex technology, but it doesn't really matter so much. It could also have been Java or anything else. So now let's play the role of an application developer and change the application. So I'm going to go into the page editor, and here we see the definition for that field that should get the value. And you see here clearly that it's defaulting the date of tomorrow, but the order value itself, that's still empty. So all now we have to do is to default this value so that it picks up the value from our DEM prediction table that goes through the database link and it gets the value from A2WC. So let me write the SQL for that. And let's run it again. So indeed, our predicted value is now automatically filled in. So this is surely going to be a very big help for our purchasing manager. And he now gets a very solid indicator of how much should be ordered. And before, he was just on his own. So even though one number may appear as a very small change in an application, for our example company, this is really going to make a huge difference. So let's come to some conclusions. We saw how machine learning gives us an accurate forecast of tomorrow's sales in this case, and this allows us to create more accurate purchase orders. And this will result in less throwaway of excess raw product and also fewer empty shelves. And by automating this process, embedding it in an application, we made it part of a business process, And this makes sure that the machine learning benefits are not just theory, but become a real positive contribution in everyday business. Now, we've also seen that ADWC is a great place to develop, to run, and to automate these machine learning processes. So we saw that ADWC is a special Oracle database. It runs in the cloud, it's managed by Oracle, and therefore it makes it very easy to get started with. I don't need any hardware, I don't have to install anything. Now, we've seen that at the basis for machine learning lies data and the preparation of data. And there's no better place to work with the data than in a database or in a data warehouse. Now, furthermore, we've seen how the notebook in ADWC gives us a very nice way to develop, to document, and to collaborate on our machine learning projects. Now, what I've not demonstrated, but what is important, is that with ADWC we can scale up the computing power whenever we need it, for example for the machine learning training phase, and then we can scale down again when we don't need that power and to save some money. Now, for organizations that already are running on enterprise databases, they surely have developers familiar with Oracle databases. And stepping up to machine learning in the database from that starting point is not difficult. These developers can reuse all their existing knowledge, for example SQL, to do the majority of the machine learning process. So how can you get started yourself with ADWC? Well, it's very easy. You actually get a $300 off budget to try out the service yourself, or in fact any of the other Oracle Cloud services. Just go to this URL and use the try for free button. Now then just follow the steps and provide your personal details. You're also asked to provide a credit card number, but this is just for verification. You're not being charged at this point in time. Now, just before I end the video, if you're watching this on YouTube, please use the subscribe button to subscribe to my channel. There are also already some other videos on there on machine learning, so watch those as well if you're interested. Now, if you have any questions or comments, or if you would like to have a conversation with me on machine learning, please use the questionnaire below. You can find that here in the link below the video, and I'm looking forward to hear your feedback. Bye.